I'm TJ Manotok, and this is your TFC News Now.
We're getting a clearer picture of the total devastation Hurricane Helene left behind in southeastern U.S. states. As of Monday, at least 120 people have been killed in six states, and officials fear the death toll can rise, with many still unaccounted for, perhaps unable to leave their location or don't have the means to communicate with family or friends, especially since more than 2 million people remain without power. Government officials and aid groups have been trying to get much-needed supplies by airlift or truck to the hardest-hit areas, but have encountered challenges due to hundreds of roads closed or remaining unpassable. Helene made landfall as a Category 4 hurricane in Florida's Big Bend region last week, and thereafter ripped through Tennessee, Georgia, the Carolinas, and Virginia.
This area was totally submerged in water.
Filipina Daphne Versosa, a Tampa, Florida resident, is used to hurricanes hitting the state. But she says Helene's wrath was the worst her family had ever experienced, especially with its unexpected storm surge.
This hurricane was really terrible for our community, for Florida, and for Tampa Bay specifically. We honestly didn't expect it to be this bad.
Meanwhile, President Joe Biden plans to visit some of the areas hit by Hurricane Helene later this week, as soon as it will not disrupt emergency response operations, according to the White House. Presidential candidates have also used the campaign trail to express their condolences and support to the victims of Helene. Donald Trump, who was scheduled to help hand out supplies in Valdosta, Georgia on Monday, slammed Biden and Vice President Harris, alleging they had a slow response to the deadly storm. While on a rally in Las Vegas, Harris expressed solidarity with affected communities and spoke about relief efforts.
More than 3,300 federal personnel have been mobilized. We are deploying food, water, and generators and working to restore water and power. And the president and I have told state and local leaders we will provide whatever help they need in the days and weeks ahead.
And finally, we head to Alberta, Canada, where the iconic 90s Filipino band River Maya reunited on stage to the delight of 7,000 fans filling the PV Mart Centrum in Red Deer.
I love ano nangyari sa show, no? Na sound check pa lang, 400 people, the venue packed to the gills. So, saya lang lahat. At maraming salamat sa lahat ng nanood.
Well, nagsimula ito sa yung first show sa Manila. Nagkaroon ng request na dalhin yung show sa iba pang parte ng mundo. So, ayan, may pinto tayo. Paano sa North America, Lake.
Ginawa niyong napakasaya ang aming first time dito. Actually, first time tumugtog ng classic lineup ng River Maya dito sa Canada. Dito sa Red Deer, first time. Ito ata so far yung pinakamaraming tao sa past 3 shows namin. So thank you lalong-lalo na yung mga nanggaling sa malayong lugar. Sa mga kaibigan namin na dumayo, maraming salamat.
And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more of our TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. I'm TJ Manotok. Stay with us, Kapamilya.
I'm Henny Espinosa, and this is your TFC News Now. President Joe Biden calls Helene's impact on the Southeast as the worst ever and committed unwavering federal aid to affected areas as he announced his visit to North Carolina on Wednesday, where homes, bridges, and roads were decimated. At least 130 people have died due to one of the strongest storms to hit the U.S., since it made landfall in Florida's Big Bend region last Thursday. Homeland Security Advisor Liz Sherwood Randall went as far to say on Monday that there could be as many as 600 deaths due to Hurricane Helene.
The current data we have is that it looks like there could be as many as 600 lost lives. But we don't have any confirmation of that. We know there are 600 who are either lost or unaccounted for. And so that work is ongoing.
According to the Red Cross, there are more than 2,400 survivors seeking shelter from Florida to North Carolina, and the road to recovery for Helene's victims is expected to be long and arduous. Damage estimates could reach more than $100 billion, according to insurers and forecasters. Power is slowly being restored to hard-hit areas, but more than 1.5 million energy customers are still in the dark. Florida Filipina Maffey Brooks recalls what it was like when Helene hit the Sunshine State.
It was probably between 60 to 70 miles per hour wind gust, and we heard branches falling on our roof. We could hear the wind howling, and it was quite a harrowing, experience just hearing all these things.
Brooks shares that the PhilAm organization in Tallahassee is actively reaching out to help victims.
The Filipino-American organization is always there also to help, our compatriots here in the city. And I think there's about 500 Filipinos living here.
And finally, disgraced music mogul Sean Diddy Combs has been slammed with a whopping 120 new sexual assault allegations that span two decades. Texas-based attorney Tony Busby announced that he's representing 120 accusers in a series of new civil lawsuits against Sean Diddy Combs. Busby says the crimes, which allegedly occurred in over 20 years, include violent sexual assault or rape, facilitated sex with a controlled substance, dissemination of video recordings, and sexual abuse of minors. Combs is currently being detained at the Metropolitan Detention Center in Brooklyn after he was charged with sex trafficking, racketeering, and transportation to engage in prostitution in an indictment unsealed last month. Combs pleaded not guilty. The hip-hop artist's legal battles have been mounting since his ex-girlfriend, Filipino-American singer Cassandra Cassie Ventura, filed a civil suit against him last year, accusing him of assault and sex trafficking during the course of their decade-long relationship. And while he vehemently denied Ventura's accusations, he did apologize after a surveillance video was leaked showing his brutal attack on Ventura at a Los Angeles hotel. And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. I'm Henny Espinosa. Stay with us, Kapamilya. I'm Henny Espinosa, and this is your TFC News Now. We begin with a vice presidential debate between Tim Walz and J.D. Vance, which many viewers found to be surprisingly civil in the final stretch of an already chaotic and tumultuous election season. In their first and only vice presidential debate before the November 5th election, the Democrats' Tim Walz and the Republicans' J.D. Vance went head-to-head on key issues like the escalating tensions in the Middle East, Hurricane Helene's impact, abortion, and the economy. With just 5 weeks before Election Day, PhilAm community leaders saw strong performances from both sides.
That was a very civilized debate. Vance was more articulate, but Tim Walz, was more a commonsensical debater.
Many are hoping the VP debate will move the needle for undecided voters.
Many people said that this vice presidential debate is not important. Yes, it is important because whatever happens to the president, you got the vice president that to lead the country. So yes, overall, I like this debate.
Meanwhile, encouraging new poll numbers for Democratic presidential nominee Kamala Harris, which shows more Asian voters choosing her over her Republican rival Donald Trump. A new APIA vote survey shows 66% of Asian American voters plan to vote for Kamala Harris, compared to 28% for Donald Trump.
What we are seeing is that earlier this year, the Filipino community was behind Biden only by 40% of the electorate. And now 68% of the Filipino voters are looking to back Harris as their presidential nominee.
Christine Chan, executive chair of the Asian and Pacific Islander Vote, tells ABS-CBN News that the rise in support for Harris among Asian voters is because of better outreach.
42% of our community of base of voters said that they were never contacted by the Democrats or the Republicans. And since then, we've actually seen an increase, right? We're seeing the Democrats, they were only reaching about 45%. Now they're reaching 62% of our electorate. Republicans, they only went from 38 to 47%.
And finally, the road to recovery for many Helene victims may be long and arduous, especially for a Filipino-American couple who lost their source of income.
Paul and Julia Pike's red food truck is now stuck in muddy debris in Asheville, North Carolina, the hardest hit by Hurricane Helene.
It took a lot of effort from both of our families for us to be at this point of actually having that truck. And opening that for only 7 months and having this to happen is really, really heartbreaking for the entire family whose income is solely relying on that truck.
Catastrophic flash flooding wiped out roadways and homes and killed more than 175 people across Florida, Georgia, Tennessee, Virginia, and the Carolinas. At least 40, including children, just from Buncombe County, North Carolina, where the Pikes live. Search and rescue continues as hundreds are still missing or unaccounted for in the aftermath of one of the strongest storms to hit the U.S.
And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. I'm Henny Espinosa. Stay with us, Kapamilya.
I'm Henny Espinosa, and this is your TFC News Now.
We begin with immigration news in Canada, with the government announcing additional tightening measures to its temporary resident program. Among the measures to be implemented is the 10% reduction in the number of study permits being issued for 2024 to 2025. Effective November 1st, there will be a higher language requirement for those applying for postgraduate work permits. University graduates will need a minimum Canadian language benchmark score of 7, while college graduates will need a minimum score of 5. One Filipino international student expressed extreme disappointment with the new restrictions.
Our family has invested heavily in Canada, both financially and emotionally. And these changes are a major blow to our hopes for building a permanent future here. Canada has become our home, and we are devastated by the uncertainty these changes have created.
Work permit eligibility will also be restricted later this year to include only spouses of master's degree students whose program is at least 16 months in duration, and to spouses of foreign workers in management or professional occupations, or in sectors with labor shortages.
The Temporary Foreign Worker Program is and has always been a last resort measure and should never be used to replace Canadian workers who want the jobs.
Meanwhile, Philippine Ambassador to Canada Maria Angelita Austria gave a reality check to Filipino international students who dream of getting their permanent residency through this immigration pathway.
Canada is a very good place to get an education. Pero most of them tell us na ang reason nila para pumunta dito ay para maging PR. Pag ang Pilipino gustong pumunta dito, kailangan ng intent mo mag-aral. Although hindi mo maaalis yung possibility na posible kang maging PR, hindi mo dapat isangla ang bahay at taya ang buong future mo sa pag-iisip na magiging PR ka, hindi yun sigurado.
Austria, who graced the convention of Filipino community leaders from across Canada in Winnipeg, said new immigration restrictions would impact more than 30,000 Filipino international students already in the country, as well as future applicants. And finally, a first-of-its-kind benefit concert is being organized in Vancouver by different Philippine organizations and bands to help victims of Typhoons Carina and Enteng in the Philippines. Proceeds of this fundraising project will go to ABS-CBN Foundation International. Some local bands were hard at work rehearsing for the Pinoy Band Aid concert this coming Saturday, October 5th, at Chando's Auditorium in Surrey.
It feels good po na sumali sa ganitong mga event kasi nakakatulong tayo. Lalo na po yung mga sa mga kabayanan ng bayan natin sa Pilipinas. Lalong-lalo na walang-wala.
Kasi ito na yung chance namin para may ano namin yung aming skills sa pag-awit. Then ito na rin yung way para makatulong kami sa ating bayan sa Pilipinas.
And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. I'm Henny Espinosa. Stay with us, Kapamilya.
I'm TJ Manotok. This is your TFC News Now.
We begin at Buncombe County, North Carolina, where rescue crews continue to work around the clock in search of more than 200 people who remain missing in the aftermath of Hurricane Helene. The death toll in what's considered the deadliest hurricane to make landfall in the U.S. mainland since Katrina in 2005 has now surpassed 200 on Thursday, and officials say that figure could rise. More than 70 people died in Buncombe County alone. Asheville Mayor Esther Mannheimer described the impact of the hurricane as unbelievable.
You can't adequately describe it in words. It's we've never seen anything like this here in Asheville. It's unprecedented.
Helene's unprecedented storm surge left many communities underwater, without power or drinkable water. Government crews have been getting help from citizen-led volunteer groups to deliver aid to stranded communities on foot and by helicopter and mule trains. Meanwhile, Guam, a U.S. island territory located in the northwest Pacific Ocean, lies on the path of typhoons. In times of calamity, when oftentimes power lines are the first to get struck, Guamanian officials are working to make the island 100% reliant on renewable energy by 2045. In August, a group of Guam energy stakeholders and government leaders gathered to discuss ways to transition Guam to 100% renewable energy in the next two decades. Power Solutions CEO Filipino Rino Manzano talks about his own company's initiatives to build a sustainable future for Guam.
The key really for us is, would it be something that could still be used 10 or 20 years from now? So we rely on new technologies. We work with our technology partners, trying to identify, hey, what would work really for the community that we would like to do renewable projects. It's not just one product. You have to really do a holistic approach, looking at identifying, okay, these are inverters, there's a lot of components in there, so you need to make sure that everything are compatible in there. And at the end of the day, it's something that should work, and it shouldn't be something that's too expensive.
Guam officials are also pushing for renewable energy to lower utility bills for consumers. Guam, which is mainly powered by expensive imported fuel oil, also hosts several energy-intensive U.S. military bases. And finally, just in time for the celebration of Philippine-American History Month this October, one of the finest U.S. institutions, Yale University, is offering Tagalog classes for the very first time, and it's set to start in the fall of 2025. The Council on Southeast Asia Studies at Yale University has officially advertised for a Filipino instructor position to be filled. The creation of a Tagalog program came after members of a Filipino student organization called CASAMA expressed their frustrations over the lack of such course. More than 380 students and faculty members signed CASAMA's petition to include Tagalog in Yale's international language courses, and their persistence paid off.
I believe that it is a recognition that Filipinos are being seen and heard in this country, and that the student population is now becoming aware of the need to be able to communicate with us in our own language.
And those are the top stories making the headlines today in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. I'm TJ Manotok. Stay with us, Kapamilya.